Hello, another Battlefield Explorer video. Today we're going to explore the Oorlogsmuseum Overloon, the Overloon War Museum, and look at a new addition that has been brought in 2 days ago by truck. In the fall of 1944, the Battle of Overloon was fought, and it was also fought in the area that I'm standing now. This battle wasn't an easy one for the Allies. It took them a couple of weeks to take this village. Maybe in another video we're going to explore the Overloon battle. Right now we're just going to focus on the museum. This museum was a battlefield museum. It was the first war museum in the Netherlands, and the founder of the museum had a vision to keep the battlefield intact and use it to show the people how a battlefield looks like after the battle is over. And all the ordnance was cleared, all the mines and all the guns and ammo, everything dangerous, and what was left was a open-air museum where some tanks that ran on the mine were still at that exact same location. Lots of other stuff was visible, and he also had this bit of sculpture made: stand still, visitor, and remind yourself that the ground on which you're standing now was one of the most heavily contested sectors of the battlefield of Overloon. Bitter was the fighting here, if man to man, and many young lives who survived the battlefields of Nettuno and Normandy were killed under these trees. Being a battlefield museum, most of their heavy vehicles and equipment was outside, and it remained outside until the 1990s, at which time the artifacts were in very poor condition. And it's here that something interesting, amazing happened. In Germany, in München Gladbach, there was a big British repair facility for armored vehicles, and it was now empty because all the vehicles were sent to the Gulf to fight in the First Gulf War, and the British government decided to close down the facility, and there were now 700 people who had nothing to do. And in secret, the captain or the commander of that facility came to Overloon and said, "Look, we've got nothing to do. We can restore your vehicles," which is what happened. And cosmetically, they weren't restored to driving order, but this saved the museum. These vehicles that have been outside for so long. This is, of course, not one of those vehicles that belong to the original collection. This is a T-34-85, a Russian tank, which has no connection at all to the Overloon battlefield, but looks nice. Then in 2000, the museum merged with the 2000-something, the museum merged with the Jaap de Groot collection, which is a massive collection of vehicles. And let's go inside and take a look, and also look at that new exhibition item that they've received. I've walked through the documentation center in which the story of World War II is told. It's impressive, but this is not what I wanted to show you today. This here is a Sherman tank from the Lucky 7th American Division, 7th Armored, which was called Lucky 7th because it did not suffer a lot of casualties during the first month of the war, first months. But this tank met its end at Overloon. Multiple hits caused the end of this tank and the end of the crew. This is one of those vehicles that had been outside for many, many years and then has had been restored by the British. You mentioned Gladbach. Next to it, maybe the most famous vehicle they have is a Panther tank from the 107 Panzer Brigade. This tank was involved in sabotaging Operation Market Garden. This was one of the tanks that made an attack on the bridge at Zon and later attacked Veghel and cut through the corridor there. The Panzer Brigade was then sent to Overloon, where this tank was abandoned or destroyed. And it's been at the museum ever since. Maybach engine that's originally used inside a Panther. So the main reason that I wanted to come here today was because of this C-47 arrived at the museum a couple of days ago and it's going to be fully restored. It needs some work. And wanted to take a look and at the same time show you guys. So the precise war history of this C-47 is not yet known. They know for sure that it took part in Operation Varsity in March of 1945, but it's not certain what else it participated in. And a guy who runs a Facebook page called Troop Carrier Command is investigating, and I can highly recommend you look up his page and follow it if you're interested in the Troop Carrier Command and Dakotas and pilots and crew who made Market Garden possible, and D-Day and Varsity and Bestone Resupply. And and here are some wings that need to be reattached. It's an interesting because you usually don't see the inside of a wing. On my left is a new pavilion that has been built, which is focusing on the Battle for Overloon, and centered around them are vehicles that were used, destroyed in the battle. So this is a Sherman Crab, a flail tank, which this drum would rotate very quickly. And there are some nice balls and chains, and these would pound the ground and explode any mines that would be hidden beneath the surface. Obviously, when a tank like this would enter the battlefield, any German anti-tank gun would open up on it as quickly as possible, because this is a threat to their defensive system. And this tank has suffered multiple hits. In front of us on the Churchill tank there is a letter. It was written by guardsman Robert Dare, who was the driver of this Churchill tank, and he wrote this letter in 1993. And in it he tells the story of what happened. And they ran over a mine around 12:30 p.m. on Thursday, 12th of October 1944, and two of the crew were killed, three were wounded. And he says that the screams of his crew mates that didn't make it out of this tank, remained with him for the rest of his life. The last survivor died in January 2007 at the age of 82. He hardly ever spoke of what happened with him during the war. The Churchill tank, and you can see the damage that the mine caused.
Still visible here.
Parked next to the Churchill tank is a Cromwell tank of the 1519th Hussars that received a direct hit on, now for us, the left-hand side. The explosion caused the hit caused the ammunition to explode, and the tank burned out completely. Has remained here ever since. There is here are some more guns here. This is a 6-pounder anti-tank gun, a 25-pounder. Park next to it. And a 5.5-inch medium gun next to that. And here is the Sherman flail. This is also an Overloon veteran, a German Nebelwerfer, which has been destroyed in the fighting and then used in the museum ever since. And these are the projectiles that it would fire. Wheels are missing. So let's take a look at the vehicles from the Jaap de Groot collection. A Jimmy Dusenhof with a quad mounted 50 cal in the bed. High speed tractor towing a 105 millimeter howitzer. It's a wrecker, Var de la France. Probably not how the Americans would say it. These cattle cars, as they called them, these were used to transport the 101st Airborne to Bastogne in these kinds of trucks. This truck here is completely filled with crates, and the crates are still filled with spare parts. It's really an amazing collection. This is a cab over engine GMC. The crates you see at the back, they are stored on a Rogers trailer, and this is how these spare parts were transported from the harbors at Normandy towards the front lines to be used to repair and keep the armies moving. It is a diamond T in front of it. M8 Greyhound parked in front. And then here is one of two M26 Pacific Dragon Wagons that they have here. This one is a late model, unarmored, and not too far from here is an armored one. My personal favorite vehicles are the high-speed tractors. This is an M4. And towing this 8-inch howitzer is an M6 high-speed tractor, which is incredible. My favorite, so I'll show you a bit more. To me, they're the best-looking vehicles of that of the war. If ever a Mack No6 prime mover could tow massive artillery guns, just as the high-speed tractors were doing. And here a display of heavy artillery. There is so much to see in this museum. You can spend all day here and then some, and you still haven't seen everything. Some nice touches in this museum. There's a man working on the phone lines. Anti-tank gun. And vehicles. And there also is the M26 Dragon Wagon, the armored version. Which is, of course, carrying a Sherman tank, which is in the process of being winched on board. A Studebaker maintenance truck with a completely original workshop in the back. Working on saving this Jeep. This is a Continental R975C1. Yes, I read it from the sign you just saw there. This was used in a Hellcat tank engine. And bridging equipment on the back. And some more bridging material here. Carried by a bolster truck. Searchlights. Anti-tank gun here. Anti-aircraft gun. And a B-25 Mitchell. This type of bomber was also used in the Doolittle raid, in which they packed a lot of these on an aircraft carrier, barely able to take off. Their extreme range, they just reached Tokyo and a couple of other cities in Japan, these types of bombers. It just goes on and on and on. I haven't shown you this German section. It's mainly American and allied vehicles that they have here, but there's also this in which they made a display of an Atlantic wall, which is facing a display of a landing operation. So a Hetzer tank, a V1 overhead, and some original bunkers from the Atlantic wall that have been moved here. Including this bunker, which was discovered years after the war, to still have a gun, and it's now here in the museum. Well, this wraps up my video about the Overloon War Museum. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you have any questions, put them in the comments or send me a message. And if you like my video, subscribe, and please check out some of my other videos that are also on YouTube already. Thank you very much for your time, thank you very much for watching, and have a great day. Bye-bye.